And they have also made me convener coach for OSL North America. So that's how like Elba and different people get to see me from time to time. And I also teach in the 26 Miracles course on Zoom now. We have a whole team of Charleston OSL that helps me teach that. So we're finishing the current one, I think, on the 1st of November, and we'll be starting again in May. I think they're handing out all the 26 Miracles courses now. You can take one, like you can start one any month now, where it used to be like, it was like me and one or two other people, but now they've expanded it. So, and that's good. That's good, I think. What else? Well, first I was going to talk about conveners. I don't know how many of you are conveners or want to be conveners. I know that Elva is a convener. I know that Laura, you're either are or, you know.
Yeah, the 20s, 30s, 40s group.
Yeah, you're a convener of that. And maybe some of the, and you're a convener, I know.
Yes,
yeah. So, my heart is for conveners. So when they asked me to do a workshop, I said, I'm going to do something for conveners, you know. But when you do that, then if you're not a convener, I didn't want to feel like people that aren't conveners couldn't come. But on the other hand, we'd love for people that aren't conveners to consider being a convener. So anyway, here we are. So in the meantime, God really put something on my heart. He also put it on Josh Acton's heart kind of independently, which is, you know, what do conveners do in OSL? That's always a big question. And, you know, did I mention I'm convener coach for OSL North America? So it was important for me to figure out what conveners do. Because, you know, I was like, nobody told me what to do when I became a convener. When we started Charleston OSL, we didn't start it in a conventional way in the sense that we weren't in a church. God just spoke to me and said, you need to start a city-wide healing, OSL healing community. Back then we called it chapters. And there were some church-based chapters back then in Charleston. But if you weren't in those churches, people would come to me and say, I want to be a healing prayer minister. What do I do? Because my wife and I were very active for many years in healing prayer ministry, and we kind of got known for our healing ministry. I said, well, I don't know, but so anyway, enough people asked me. I said, well, just come alongside us, you know, just come alongside us. But then what was us? So I knew John Rice and a few people, and we'd been OSL members for years, but we weren't really, we weren't in a healing community or anything like that. So God spoke to me, us, and said, well, start a citywide healing community because you got all these people out here in the city that want to be healing prayer ministers, and their churches, they don't know what to do with them, and they don't go to these churches where there's OSL, so start and see what happens. So we did start that. We went to the east side of Charleston, one of the poorest, most disadvantaged parts of the city, and we met a man called Brother Dallas, and Brother Dallas is this huge black man. He loved the Lord, man. He loved the Lord. I said, we want to come and bring a ministry that wants to pray. He said, you know, he said, I've had a lot of people come to me that want to give food or clothing, medical. You're the first one that ever came and said that they want to pray. I said, so he said, you come alongside us. And so he became our first chaplain of the new OSL community. And back then, John Rice was the regional director, and John came and commissioned our healing community. So we didn't know what to do except for pray, prayer walk. We would have like feeding events, and people would come from all over that neighborhood, and we would pray for them, and we would have lunch for them, and we'd pray for them. And so we just started doing prayer stuff. I mean, every Wednesday we'd meet in the church, his church. In fact, Brother Dallas really didn't want us in his church. He said, we need to move out of the church. But at the time, we were a bit disorganized and we didn't really have a place to go. So he let us stay in his church and meet. But every Wednesday we would come, a group of us would come and we would pray. We would just pray from 7 to 8 in the evening. Later on, I got I'm a medical doctor, retired now, but I was invited to become medical director of the Dream Center Medical Clinic in North Charleston, which was a faith-based nonprofit that served the medical underserved in this North Charleston, which is, well, it's high crime, poverty, a lot of immigrants were there, and disadvantaged folks. So when I became medical director, I said, you know, I really want to have a prayer ministry here. And we were already had our OSL community. So I invited all our OSL community to come and pray and at the Dream Center. So every patient that came in the door of the Dream Center got prayed for, at either before they were seen by the physician or after. And well, they said, well, what if they don't want prayer? I said, if they don't want prayer, I said, we can give them a blessing and we can give them a Bible. And so that's what we ended up doing. And then we got involved in the community. We started making prayer rounds, and the police invited us to come with them on their community policing when they'd go walk in the city. And so we'd go and pray for people along with the police when they were making their rounds. It just kind of went on and on. We did something called Adopt a Block, where we each one of us would choose a block in that around the Dream Center. And these are pretty rough areas too, by the way. There were like killings and drug deals almost every day, going something going down there, horrible stuff, wrecks, young people dying. So we would go and we would prayer walk on the Adopt a Block day. We'd walk our block and we'd knock on doors and pray with people and really shine the light of Jesus. And it was having such an impact. It was really amazing, along with the medical clinic. So all that ended when the COVID came. The clinic closed, the Adopt a Block stopped, and we still haven't recovered from that yet. So Charleston OSL went kind of virtual at that point. And that's how I got to know so many of you. That was pretty neat. Yes. Like, I got to know Hollis and Elba and Laura and all of you. So, and John. So, in fact, most of you I've never seen before in person. So, isn't that crazy? Yet I know you. So anyway, getting back to this. So what are we going to talk about today? So I thought we might talk about what conveners do and, you know, but that's pretty boring, really. So God put something on my heart about 3-4 months ago, maybe 6 months, I can't remember. Said, I'm always challenging our healing community, you know, we need to go, well, our prophetic word for 2022 was to go higher. Higher was the prophetic word. The word for 2023 is deeper. That's our prophetic word for 2023. So we have a leadership team in Charleston OSL of 11 people. There's 11 of us, including 3 chaplains and various other people. In fact, your friend Colin is on our leadership team in Charleston OSL. Okay. Because we need good teachers. One thing we wanted to have was good teachers, you know. So Colin's obviously a good teacher, right? I don't know a better teacher than Colin, actually.
That's
so
great.
Anyway, Colin Campbell from Hamilton, Ontario. So he's on our leadership team. So it's not like we want everybody off to be on, but we have a nice mixture of people that are in the Charleston area and some that aren't, that are on our leadership team. Now that with Zoom, it doesn't matter where you live. Anyway, I challenged them. I said, what does it mean to go higher? And so we had a little discussion about that. So then I began to challenge them to go higher. So we were always teaching 26 miracles. And so I said, we need to bring more studies online. So I challenged Colin and Mary Lee, who's our co-convener, and Pastor Ed, who's one of our chaplains, to develop a course to follow 26 miracles. Now, I know OSL is doing this at a much higher level. It's called, they're offering Next Steps, and I'm not trying to compete with that. But they developed something called Healing in Acts, which actually Paul Feider, who's in the next room, wrote that book. And so we brought that online for a 9-week study. So that was kind of one of the contributions for 2022. The other thing we did was we're very big on the Unbound ministry. I know, Hollis, you've taken our Unbound course. In fact, Hollis is now one of our Unbound intercessors, so that she can serve on one of our Unbound prayer teams.
Awesome.
So Unbound, if you're not, you may or may not be familiar. In fact, John, you also took my Unbound offering, and he's also he's not only an intercessor, he's a lead prayer minister in our Unbound program. I forgot that. Sorry about that. So they've already started ministering Unbound.
It's a great course.
So yeah. So Unbound is basically, you know, it's called the Five Keys to Freedom. Neil Lozano developed it, and I won't go into it here, but you're all invited to take Unbound, by the way, from us if you'd like to. We're probably going to offer it soon. If not soon, then it'll be after the first of the year. But anyway, deeper, okay, that's where we're operating now. So God said, you know, you're doing a great job raising up prayer ministers, but you know, what are you doing with discipleship? And I thought, yeah, what are we doing with discipleship? And what should OSL conveners be doing with discipleship? And so, I didn't know. But the Word of God always has the best answer, I found. So as I started looking in the Word, you know, and like, I've listed some of these scriptures in your handout, and this is just some of the scriptures that God started giving me. But then there was a book. I don't read books much, by the way. Usually if I buy a book, it sits on the shelf and maybe I'll pick it up. And I mean, there's some, don't get me wrong. I'm not against books, but you know, I don't know. It's just like, what do you do with your time? Well, so I was just praying one day with one of my devotionals, and they were advertising this book, and get the name of this book. It's called Called to Christian Joy and Maturity, Forming Missionary Disciples. Well, I substitute, because you know, mission is a very important part of what we do as conveners. We're all about not just being in a group like this, but going out, you know. Forming, so that title really resonated with me. It's by a man named Gordon D. Marais, M-A-R-A-I-S, and Daniel Keating. And so I got that book. I started reading it. I said,
"This is." Say the name of it one more time, please.
It's called "Called to Christian Joy and Maturity: Forming Missionary Disciples." It's by Gordon D. Marais, D-E-M-A-R-A-I-S, and Daniel Keating, K-E-A-T-I-N-G. And these two men have developed very wonderful missionary discipleship programs. And so that's what they were writing about. A lot of it is scripture, a lot of it is their own experience. Turns out that Brother John Rodham here has also written and produced material on that too, which I appreciated John sending me his material on that, by the way, and I enjoyed it. Okay, so getting back to what's going on with then Josh Acton, you know, our North America director, he put out this thing to some of the board people. He said, I've got this vision now that OSL North America should be about forming healing disciples for Jesus. So I wrote Josh back. I said, thank you very much, Josh. That confirms what Guy was telling me, too. So since we've been here, he and I have been having some very lively conversation about that as well. Anyway, this seems to be where the heart of God is moving, and it kind of makes sense. You know, a lot of times what God says, it doesn't immediately make sense to us, but it kind of does, because, you know, we're very good in OSL about training people, you know, to be healing prayer ministers, right? But isn't there something more to being in the healing ministry than just, you know, praying over people and seeing them healed, as wonderful as that is, you know? Isn't it better, isn't the higher thing, or the deeper thing, let's say, to be able to lead someone into a saving relationship with Jesus, or deepen that for them, you know? Isn't that kind of one of the ultimate healings that we see? And I don't want to make this all me talking, by the way. So anyway, as I read and prayed, I came up with these 8 points. Some of these points had already been made. Some of them I added. But I thought we'd just go over those for a few minutes, and then we could discuss, you know, what you all might think about that, how you might all appropriate that into your own role as convener. I think you're going to hear more about it, because I think Josh is really going to get the word out about this. And he's already asked me to help him do that. So in a sense, one of the things I'm doing today is helping Josh in his role to get OSL into making healing disciples. One thing I would say about that, I've started that in our leadership team, that thinking, you know, it's like, I want to tell you guys what God's been speaking to me, and get ready, because next year, you know, we're going to start making healing disciples for Jesus. So how does that look? Well, I don't know how it looks, to tell you the truth. I don't really have a clue, but you know who does? God does. And you know, everything we need to know is in God's word. And part of it is like figuring out what's going on, you know? So he's always showing us, and he's always giving us stuff. Anyway, the first point is that, you know, and we're all disciples. I want you to know that right now. We're all disciples. We may all be on a little bit different level of discipleship, but we're all kind of disciples on this incredible journey that Jesus has for us. We wouldn't be sitting here otherwise. We'd be, I don't know, going to the flower gardens or something. But I don't know what they do in Oregon, but something wonderful, I don't know. This is the most wonderful thing we can do as far as I'm concerned. So disciples are called and chosen by Jesus. I mean, as much as we might want to be a disciple, we don't have the final say in that. You know, we're called, you know. And I put some scriptures down, you know, particularly this one, Matthew 4, 19 through 22. It says, Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, you know, and he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and his brother Andrew, and they were casting a net into the lake. And Jesus said, "Come and follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people." So at once they left their nets and followed him. So Jesus called them, and they responded to that call. So that's the normal way that, you know, disciples are called, and they're chosen. I mean, he could have probably chosen a bunch of other fishermen, but for whatever reason, because he knew, he's listening to Father God, who was showing him what to do, which we all need to learn how to do that, you know, to listen to God's voice, and then obey it. I think those are two key points I want to make here. It also says, going a little farther, he says he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in the boat preparing their nets. And Jesus called them, and immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. So you see how Jesus is, you know, calling people. Well, Jesus calls people to us, too, to our healing communities. They want to belong to our healing communities. Oftentimes they'll come by, the way we used to do it in our healing community was to start a 26 miracle study. And we would invite people from all over the city to come and join that study. And we did that for years. Now OSL has kind of said, well, you know, we really need to do this with these online training. And I think that's good. And not only that, but they're actually training people how to do it. I was never trained in how to teach 26 miracles, but yet over time we developed a wonderful curriculum. I'm saying wonderful. What do you?
Oh, it's wonderful. Yes.
Yeah, it's pretty good. What?
It's great. Yeah. And it's interesting.
Yeah.
The lessons are captivating.
Yeah.
And then you give people time to pray together.
Yeah. So we try to bring the each of the miracles to life. You know that mm-hmm. These are not just like some text. You know. I mean, this is a living, breathing thing, mm-hmm. and I could go on about 20.
And that's the thing that you do, excuse me, Dr. Mike, is you bring it to life. I studied the Bible for a little while, at work with some people from China, mm-hmm. some Christians from China. Mm-hmm. And so I said, well, I'll take a chapter. And so I took a chapter and I ran through it, you know, and it was like in the book of Acts. And they sort of looked at me like they took one or two verses and they looked at them and very carefully and looked at what was going on. And I was used to reading scripture just like, you know, yeah. I've heard this before. So that's what you're doing in the 26 miracles yeah, yeah. is we're digging into it.
Really unpacking it, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. More than anything, though, we want to show you what is Jesus teaching you in this particular healing account. Not what I'm teaching, but what is Jesus teaching you? So we look at some other scriptures, you know, John 15. In fact, Jesus makes the comment. He says, You didn't call me, I called you. He even says it right there. He says, I called you to make fruit, you know, for the kingdom of God. In Ephesians 2:10 says that, I'm just paraphrasing now because I'm not going to read them all, but it says that we are God's handiwork, created for good works that God prepared for us even before we were born. So God's already prepared. Not that this is like, what is the term?
Predetermined,
yeah. This is not what it's talking about. It's like, because we have an option. We don't have to do the good works that's been prepared for us, you know. If it's a predestination, then we kind of have to do it. We're stuck with it,
right.
You know. So this is not that. Mm-hmm. This is like you volunteer. There's a fun term with volunteer these days. My son, we were out eating with my son the other night, I volunteered to take Josh to the back and forth from the hotel. He said, you were, I forget the term.
Voluntold?
What is it?
Voluntold?
Yeah, voluntold. That's it. I knew you'd know that. He said, no, you were voluntold.
I do that.
That's not being made in for good works. Good works is totally optional. That requires a response on your part. Okay, Matthew 28:16-20. We all know this one, the Great Commission, right? You know, to go and make disciples of all nations, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I will be with you. There's a promise with it, that he's going to be with us to the end of the age when we do this, you see. So we've got his call. You know, not everybody that comes to Charleston OSL or takes 26 miracles, they don't all hang around, you know. They might decide they have other things to do, or they're called in a different way, but they're not necessarily called to walk in our fellowship. So, you know, we only want the ones really that are called and chosen by Jesus for us. And but you know what? You all qualify, so not to feel bad about that. Okay, number two. I'm watching the time. I know we have very limited time. But, and I also want us to have discussion and maybe have a chance to pray for each other, or at least pray. It's interesting because, you know, OSL, I'm getting sidetracked, but I think I have to, because God wants me to tell you stuff. OSL is first and foremost a prayer ministry, you know? And I think that, I don't want to say we forget that, but I think that sometimes we lose sight of the fact that we're basically people of prayer. We're people that love to pray, you know. If you don't love to pray, you probably shouldn't be in OSL, because that's first and foremost what we do. So, like, you know, in our meetings, for instance, we need to pray for each other, you know. When we go out and God puts somebody in front of us, we shouldn't have to ask permission. We just need to go and pray for that person right then and there. So if you think about it, you know, there are many types of prayer, obviously, but this is a ministry of intercession, because intercession means that we are standing in the gap between the supplicant and God. And, you know, so we're like the mediators of healing, because we can't heal of our own power. We can't heal anybody. You know, I'm a physician. I couldn't heal anybody. Most of my patients are dead now. You know, so I could make them feel better for a while, but I can't heal them like God heals them. If you want, yeah. So anyway, So we're a prayer ministry, and we need to remember that, you know? And I hope we never lose sight of the fact that, you know, it's nice to sell books and nice to do a lot of this stuff is important. But, I mean, if we just all came in there and prayed, I think that would be the heart of what OSL is. So, and I always stress that the main thing is prayer for us. Number two, discipleship is costly. If you're going to become a disciple of Jesus, particularly a healing disciple, it's going to cost you something. Yeah. And I think it costs us all something different, you know? So obviously it costs, you know, these disciples, they had businesses and they just left them, you know? And it seems like, and Jesus tells us, he tells us in Matthew 8, Luke 9, and in Matthew 4, he says, you know, people come to Jesus and say, we want to follow you. He says, well, you know what? He says, you know, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head, which means, like, you want to follow me? Get ready, because, you know, you're going to be, like, out there on the street. You're not going to know what's coming next. You know, you're going to have to put all your faith and trust in me. So even though it is costly to follow Jesus, he's going to help you with that. It's not like he's just going to say, yeah, forget it. You know, you left your family. Too bad. He's going to give you something more, even more wonderful in exchange for what you left. And I know in my own case, I love to hear about your case, what it's cost you. But, you know, I was a physician. I had a very wonderful practice. I had everything the world could offer, you know. But when I started praying for people, and started going, even doing the things we were doing and going on mission trips, we started doing these healing missions to Honduras and India. I know you're going to India soon, that's exciting. These were the most wonderful times that we've ever had in our life. They were full of joy. And fortunately, my wife, she was a nurse, she accompanied me on most of these trips. And we really had the time of our life, you know, praying for people, watching healings happen. Signs, wonders, and miracles. I said, I can't believe the stuff that I've seen, you know. You've heard about some of it. And you'll see it too. But anyway, it is costly, but the price you pay, I mean, and the price could be your life, you know, it really could. We've gone in some of the worst areas. We've exposed ourselves to stuff. I was going to Honduras one time, and I got scared. The night before we were leaving, I just got, a fear came over me that was incredible. And I turned it over to God, and I said, God, you know, I just feel I'm leaving everything I know to go to this jungle place. And I don't know the system at all. You know, I'm just putting it in somebody else's hands. And he spoke to me, and he said, it's okay, I've got this. Yeah, that's what he said. And they said, that fear just left me. And we had the most glorious 4-week mission trip. After that, I can't imagine. If I told you what happened, you wouldn't believe it. Anyway, it's costly. The third thing is that, I know we're going to run out of time. Disciples are taught by Jesus. I mean, right? Then, if you're going to find, but Jesus isn't around anymore, you know. So now our OSL community becomes the primary vehicle for teaching. So, you know, we are basically, you know, commissioned by Jesus to do this stuff. So Jesus isn't going to, like Jesus taught his disciples. I mean, it should, in Matthew chapter 4, it was about he healed people. And the disciples got to watch him, and then they got to participate in it, which was coming in point 4. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus teaches, 5 through 7. We all know that one, right? The Sermon on the Mount. That was a lot of teaching in there about, you know, what the kingdom of God was about, and they heard that. And then Matthew chapter 8, he goes back to healing, you know. So what was he doing? Healing, teaching, preaching, and destroying the works of darkness. That was Jesus' ministry, and proclaiming the kingdom of God. And so that has to become our ministry too. So when we're doing those things, then we're fulfilling his ministry. That's why we study the 26 miracles, so that we can learn how he did it and then apply it to our own ministries. Discipling includes hands-on training. For instance, in Matthew chapter 8, 23 through 27, he calms a storm, you know? And the punchline in that one is, he said, he calmed the storm, he just spoke a word and it was calm. Everybody else was, you know, they were fighting, they were afraid, they didn't know what to do, and they're waiting for Jesus. So he says something like, "Oh, you have little faith," meaning, why didn't you guys calm the storm? You guys know how to calm a storm, you know? And so he rebukes them a lot, but it's all part of the training program, you know? Mm-hmm. So that doesn't mean I get to rebuke people a lot. I mean, but I feel better about it when I do it because I know Jesus did it with the disciples. All right, this is really cool. In Matthew 14, I don't rebuke people that much, by the way. In Matthew 14, he feeds 5,000 people, right? But who did he use to help him?
The disciples.
And the little boy with the, you know, had the fish, right? He used them. So they got to get some hands-on training then too, you know. Of course, he says, you give them something to eat, you know. It's like, you do it, you know. I was in India one time, and we were praying for the lepers in the village, laying hands on the lepers. And all my team was like, oh, we're too tired to go today. This is one of the most wonderful things you've ever done, is to go to the leprosy village and lay hands on, because you feel like, you know, this is like what Jesus did, and you get to do it now. So then we had to go to the leprosy hospital and go to all the wards and pray for all the leprosy patients. And so the rest of them that had gone through the village said, we can't do it, we're too tired, and we got a big program coming up, and we're not ready. And so it was just me. So I got kind of put off about the opposite to these people, you know?
Mark.
And so...
like Mark.
Yeah. So here I am in the hospital. So I said, God, how could you let this happen? He said, my grace is sufficient for you. So I went in that hospital. I prayed for every patient, every leprosy patient. I prayed for their families. I prayed for the staff. I prayed for the doctors. I prayed for the Hindu priests. And when I came out of there, I said, thank you, Lord. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord. But I had to let that hardness melt away from my heart. Mm-hmm. So, and you know what? When Jesus lets you do something as a disciple, you don't always do it right. You know, part of it is, you know, learning by experience, you're going to make some mistakes, you know, but God's grace is sufficient. So he's going to pick up, your mistake is going to be, you know, converted into his glory in some way. And of course, we know the story of Peter walking on the water, you know. Jesus is walking, that's Matthew 14. And so Peter sees him, he's not sure if it's Jesus. So he says, if it's you, Lord, tell me to walk on water. And so, because he was far off, you know. So Peter steps out of the boat. He's successfully walking on water as he looks at Jesus. And then the wind, you know, starts picking up and it distracts him. As soon as it does, he sinks, right? But Jesus is right there to lift him up and take him by the hand. And he puts him back in the boat, you know. And then, of course, I love this one because this is one of the healing accounts. In Matthew 17, they come down from the Mount of the Transfiguration. And Peter, James, and John were with him, but the rest of the disciples were down in the valley. And here's this, they were trying to cast a demon out of this boy, and they couldn't do it. And they were arguing with the Pharisees and all that sort of thing, you know. Funny story. Mm-hmm. So Jesus sees the commotion. He says, what's going on? He said, well, we asked your disciples to cast the demon out, but they couldn't do it, you know. And I'm not going to go through the whole story. So Jesus rebukes them. He says, you faithless and perverse generation. He calls them a faithless and I never want to hear Jesus say that to me. You faithless and perverse generation. Mm-hmm. What if I said to my healing class, you faithless and perverse class, I've been trying to teach you all this stuff and you still don't get it. I mean, wow. Wow. So anyway, so Jesus cast the demon out, and then the disciples privately, they ask him, you know, they say, why couldn't we cast it out? So then it's a teachable moment, right? It says, you didn't have enough faith. This can only come out by prayer and fasting, et cetera, et cetera. So he uses everything to teach. And so that's the hands-on training. Okay, discipleship happens in community. There's a very practical reason for that. There's a place for one-on-one discipleship. But if you just had one disciple for your entire life, you wouldn't get to do much discipleship. So discipleship needs to happen in a group like this, so that we can form disciples, so that these disciples can make other disciples, et cetera, et cetera. So there's kind of a multiplier effect. So it's going to happen in community. And I'm going to skip to point seven, that discipleship happens with groups of different sizes. I mean, it's good to have like one-on-one discipleship. And I have that in my own healing community. There's one young fellow, he's in his 40s, but I've been discipling him, and that's good. But I don't spend all my time discipling him, you know. Then, Jesus had what? Peter, James, and John. That was like his inner circle. And so he was always taking them to raise the dead girl and to come down from them, go up to the Mountain of Transfiguration. And when there was difficult stuff, he would take them. He wouldn't take the others. So we need to have in our healing community, like if you're the convener, you need to have a core leadership group that you can go to and that you can really pour into. And then, of course, you have the 12. And then, of course, Jesus, he sent the 12 out on mission in Matthew 10, but Luke 9. He sends them out on mission. But then when they come back, he sends out 72 others. So now, you know, there's a lot of work to do. So he had to kind of quickly disciple these other ones so that there could be 70 go out. Well, with us in our healing communities, we need to be discipling, you know, groups of 3, groups of 12, groups of 20, groups of 70, if you know, we have that influence in that group. So, okay. Another one, discipleship includes being sent on mission. So OSL healing communities need to be going out on mission. And God will show us, and as conveners, we need to be looking for opportunities to take OSL on mission. It could be right out in the street here, could be at Walmart, could be doing community policing, walking with the police and praying. It could be anything, yeah. And of course, now we're on Zoom. So how do I deal with my healing community on Zoom if we want to do a community event? So one Saturday, we decided we would walk around City Hall and just pray. And so we have people from like your Seattle or wherever, Kirkland, I guess you're from, and other people from different areas. I said, okay, for our people in wherever you are, just walk around your city hall, and then we'll come back and we'll give testimonies about what happened. So we got some wonderful testimonies. I mean, there was a guy who had been beaten up the night before, and he was going to make a report to the police, and said one of our group stopped him and prayed for him, you know, and they walked. There was a coffee shop across from City Hall, and they went in there and they bought everybody coffee and prayed for them. Pretty amazing stuff. But that's what happens when you release people to be healers for Jesus in the community. That stuff is exactly what happens. Have I finished this yet? I'm getting close. Okay, so discipleship is a lifelong process. So, I've been around 78 years. I still need to be discipled, you know. My discipleship training's not over. It's like I tell my kids, life's a university and I'm still paying tuition, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm still paying tuition in the school of discipleship. So don't feel like, you know, after you get to a certain age or stage, maturity is good, by the way, but maturity and discipleship are two different things. You know, I can know a very mature person who has never been discipled or never discipled anybody. So discipleship kind of works independently of your age or stage. So, and there's some scripture to support the fact that it is a lifelong process. Of course, John 20, we know, this is a post-resurrection appearance of Jesus. He goes into the upper room where they're all hiding out, you know, and he breathes on them and he says, peace be with you. And then he says, you know, receive the Holy Spirit. And so they all get the Holy Spirit. And then he says, if you forgive the sins of any, they're forgiven. But if you retain the sins of any, they're retained. So he gives them incredible power, authority over sin, man. You know, isn't that amazing? And we have that same power and authority ourselves. And, you know, I always ask people, are you forgiving people's sins? I mean, are you retaining sins? You know, there's some sins that I'm not going to be able to forgive because they're too horrific. But I can always turn them over to the higher authority. In fact, in Acts, I could go on about this. In Acts 5, you know, Ananias and Sapphira, they come before Peter and they said, and he says, where's the money? You didn't give all the money, right? He said, sorry, you're gone. And they both dropped dead. Now, I'm not saying we should mediate that sort of, retain that sin. I mean, our default position should be to forgive, right? In Jesus' name. And also, in healing prayer, we need to be able to lead our supplicants into forgiveness, to forgive the people that have wronged them. Otherwise, they won't be able to receive the full grace that God has for them. So, I think I'm going to have to finish here. Anyway, in the book of Acts, you see the fruit of that discipleship. These disciples now go out, they heal, you know, they destroy the works of Satan, they raise people from the dead, and they proclaim the gospel all over the world. And that's our legacy, folks. That's our legacy as members of OSL. We need to be doing those very same things. And not just, now, I don't want to say not just praying for healing, because you know that's a wonderful thing that we do, and that's a special thing we've been called to. But we're called to so much more, you know. Thank you for listening. Comments or questions?
So my question is, what does a convener do? 'Cause
I have a paper that has a convener job description that I would be glad to email you.
When
give me your email and I'll do that.
Well, I kind of just, I don't know if God called me to be a convener, but when I talked to him, he didn't say, don't do it. And it was just so on my heart to change it from a meeting with all this business to get right into the prayer. Mm-hmm. And there's a little resistance in the older members that are wonderful Christian people, and they bring so much to the group, but I just so strongly feel pray. And it was wonderful during the Zoom times, because we used to write our prayer concerns and then just put our hands on it and pray over it in a prayer in unison at the end of the meeting. Now in Zoom, we had a chance to go one by one and lift them up. And somehow, not being right smack in person, people could lift their hearts up to God. And it brought us so close as a group that now when we meet, I have us go from person to person and we pray. You know, they may pray the prayers for themselves or others do. And the words are, the prayers are astounding. The unity it's given us.
Yeah.
So I just really loved hearing you say that.
Yeah.
And it's hard to get away from the treasurer's report.
Yeah.
And also we had to prove to the IRS that we are nonprofit.
Yeah,
they
yeah.
really picked on us. And so we have to have minutes to prove.
Yeah.
So
right. yeah.
but I'm really trying to minimize it, and I yeah. encourage that to everybody.
Yeah. But you know, you can have your business meetings with your officers can be outside of your community meetings. They don't have to be in there. So we, you know, we have a board, and so our board operates. We don't operate independently of our leadership team. But when we have a meeting, we say, now this is board business. Boom, boom, boom. Minutes, etc., etc. We're also a nonprofit, so we have to do all that stuff too. And we have to have a conflict of interest policy. We have to, but I don't want that garbage to get into the general time of healing, you know, our monthly meeting. I'd say garbage. It's not garbage. It's just
business. Yeah.
You know, I belonged to the chapter Goodness and Mercy in St. Louis. but our chapter kind of disbanded because everyone was retiring and moving to other cities, and so there was only two of us left. And the other person was quite busy in her church, so it was just me. And I was not compelled to be a convener. And Becky Morrison, because I'm in Region 4, Becky Morrison kept saying, Janine, you should be the convener. And I said, no, I'm not doing it. I had so much else going on, and I felt overwhelmed with what else was going on. So I said, no more, Becky. And after about 6 months of that, she finally gave up. And so, of course, there's no chapter in St. Louis. And I still felt that way for a very long time, that I did not want to be the convener or start the chapter. And then I was sitting in the sanctuary today, and I was talking, this one woman came up to me, her name is Diane, I don't remember her last name. But she said, she started telling me about, she's been with OSL for, I don't know, maybe a year or two. And she has become the convener, and how it happened in her church where she started a chapter with the help of her pastor. And I don't know, God just said, Janine, pay attention. And so now I'm starting to feel like maybe this is what God's wanting me to do, because I really miss the OSL chapter. I miss that gathering, I miss that fellowship, I miss praying with other people. And our church has a prayer team, but it's not as compelled to do what I want our prayer team to do. And I'm the leader, supposedly, of that group, and I can't get them to do anything.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping now, I'm thinking maybe if, with my pastor, we can get something started. So,
yeah.
Encourage them to join this man's course. It's amazing.
Right. Yes.
Well, amazing. She was talking about how they were doing the 26 Miracles study on Zoom. And I mean, I've heard about it for months and months, and still didn't feel compelled to do anything about it. But after talking to Diane and all she did, I just think, oh, maybe this is possible.
Yeah. And so also, I'm the convener coach for OSL North America, and I'd be glad to communicate with you more about how you could get something started. Okay. Every community is different in by virtue of location, by virtue of who you're connected to, whether it's a church, you know, whether you're, you know, outside of a church. I like the ones outside of church, because then I don't have to mess with the pastor and all. I tried to do it in several churches, and it just doesn't work for me. Mm-hmm. I guess the way I want to do it doesn't fit with the church so much, you know. And then the church, well, I don't think.
I don't think our pastor would want to be directly involved.
Yeah.
Because she's a pastor, she's got so much else going on.
Yeah.
But I think she might be very supportive of the idea.
Well, that's,
Have you met Gail Zinda, who's the new Region 4 director?
I did last night, just for a second.
Because she's full of enthusiasm, and she could be so helpful.
What's her last name?
Zinda.
Okay.
Is that Litton?
Her name is, she goes by two names.
I'm sorry, it is Littmer.
Yeah, Gail Littmer is who that is.
I didn't get my
name. But her also, I don't know if her maiden name is Zinda.
That's right, she's going by Littmer.
Okay.
But it comes up both ways on my phone. Yeah.
So we're supposed to stop at 2. I think there's another work. Isn't there another workshop at 2:15 or something?
No, I think this is from 1:15 to 2:15.
We're on a break, I think, for a bit.
I think this is
at
2:45.
What is it?
The next one starts at
2:45.
Yeah,
we go to 2:15.
Mine goes to 2:15.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, that's good.
We're not going to let you off the hook. I've got at least 3 more hours on my phone.
Okay.
So quick, what does a convener do?
What is a convener? I mean, typically, you know, have you ever been like the leader of a small group, some sort of small faith group or something like that, you know? I mean, that's kind of what a convener does, but you're the leader of a healing prayer group along with your chaplain. You know, to have an OSL healing community, you need a convener, a chaplain, and 3 other members for a total of 5. That's the OSL's definition of a healing community now. So usually it's not too difficult to get that. Sometimes it's difficult to get a chaplain, That's where John here is OSL North America chaplain coach.
Yeah, so tell me who your chaplain is and we'll do a double whammy on it.
OSL North America right here.
Well, you know, that's the thing, I don't know of anyone in our church that would be, well, I guess I know of a couple people that might be considered, could be a chaplain.
Yeah.
That are not the pastors of the church.
Right. A chaplain doesn't have to be an ordained chaplain. I mean, like a seminary ordained. Now, if you correct me if I'm wrong. Yeah, but we have three chaplains in Charleston OSL. One is an evangelical pastor who's been pastoring a long time in a huge evangelical church. He was the director of Healing Prayer. I don't even know if he's been to seminary. I don't know what his upbringing in the faith was, you know. But he's our lead chaplain. I mean, you wouldn't want Pastor Jack.
That's great.
Yeah. And then we have Pastor Ben. He's the one that does the Unbound ministry. And again, I don't know if he's ever been to any Bible college or not, but he's a pastor in this church called Crosstown Church. It's non-denominational, obviously. Was planted by the Assemblies of God. And then we have Pastor Ed Stiltz, who is a Methodist pastor, but not in the sense, I think they have two, and maybe some of you know Methodist, I don't.
They have local pastors, yeah. And they have ordained pastors.
I think he's the local type pastor, you know. Mm-hmm. But again, he loves OSL, and so those are our chaplains. So again, you don't have to be super ordained.
Yeah, we're really desperate. So
you know, I'm wondering if a lay leader, which is what United Methodists have, they're not, I don't even think they go to seminary, but they do a lot of study to be a lay leader. Mm-hmm. And so they might.
That's a conversation maybe for you and John to have.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I can work with you. I can already tell you qualified to be a convener. So. And we have.
I could find someone else. I'm sure.
You just,
it's
prayed
a fun
and God
ministry.
Spoke to
it's
you.
It's a very special ministry.
Now, you want to confirm that call, by
right,
the way.
I do.
You do. And then when you do want to do that, then you go on the OSL Today website, and where is it located? There's one of the buttons that's got a convener
resources.
Application.
Resources?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
It's a convener application. There's
okay.
Also a chaplain application. Yeah. That needs to be filled out. That convener application will come to me. You will receive a call from me, and then we'll go over all that stuff.
Same with me for the chaplain.
Do we have to have a chaplain in place in order to have people take the course?
Take the
Zoom part of it. Like
the Zoom Zoom course is independent of all.
Well,
that.
That's what I mean. Would I have to have all that in place just to get people to participate in the study?
Okay. People can sign up individually.
Okay.
That there's no requirement other than that they're an OSL member to take the Zoom study.
Okay.
Yeah. Often what happens is that clergy, for example, join the course and get really excited about it, and then a lot of people that become chaplains through
okay.
the course.
Okay.
Yeah, that might be a way somebody gets called to be a chaplain is by taking the course.
That's
so, like I said, there's a course now offered every month. So it used to be you had to wait till the next one rolled around,
right.
but now they're offered every month
that's,
through May.
That's the other thing Diane was saying, is that they're offered every month, and I thought, well, at least there's a more often opportunity, and people don't have to wait 6 months or whatever it
right.
is
mm-hmm,
till I get my stuff together to do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ours starts in May, so we want you to take ours, of course.
Well, that May.
No pressure.
We're just finishing one now,
okay.
So.
And being a convener doesn't mean you have to do everything.
Right.
Right.
Like a lot of groups will have a secretary and a treasurer and
right.
they'll have a team. So.
Yeah, we had that in our chapter.
Yeah.
We had all of that
team.
Once upon a time.
Have you already taken 26 miracles?
I have, but, yeah.
I mean, that to be a convener, you don't have to necessarily take the Zoom one.
You're right.
That wouldn't be a requirement for you.
Well, you know, Diane made a good point that I could take the course, take the lesson, the study again, just because it's been so long.
Oh yeah, no, I think it'd be good.
And it would probably, if I can get other people interested, it might be good for them to see that I'm still a part of it. I'm still participating and active. It might spur them instead of them just being there with somebody they don't know and maybe thinking, oh, it's not that important because Janine's not even on here, so.
Yeah.
Mike, if I have a prayer group in my church, could I invite them to take the course like yours?
Absolutely.
Without being an OSL member, but then maybe it would make them want to join OSL?
The only thing is, to take it, you have to join OSL.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Yeah, but, so you know, I tell people that are just searching, you might say, or I'd like to take the course. I said, well, join OSL for 1 year. If you don't like it, you don't have to renew. Nobody says you got
to
renew.
Great thing to say.
But I mean, it's like, that's what it, the cost, $45, I don't know what it is now, $45.
I think it's 40.
Yeah.
Maybe it's 40.
So that's like the cost of the course, but it also includes OSL membership, sharing magazine, all these wonderful things that we do.
And
for a year. Who wouldn't want to be a part of it? I can't think of a reason you wouldn't want to.
Are you a salesman? You were a surgeon?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's just.
Did you talk people into surgery?
You know, it's interesting. Now that you mention that, that's good. In my early days, I mean, there wasn't any surgery I wouldn't do. There wasn't any thing that I wouldn't take on, you know, in my early days. Mm. As I got older in surgery, there were less and less surgeries that and toward the end, it's like I'm trying to talk most people out of surgery. Mm. And toward the end of my practice.
Yeah, you learned something.
Yeah. I mean, but part of it was my enthusiasm. Mm-hmm. Part of it was my training. I mean, I was trained up in that day to be able to do, you name it, I'd do it. And I wasn't afraid either.
Right.
But it's not a... And then I got into healing prayer in the middle of my surgical practice along with my wife. And we would start praying for people, and we'd see healings even before they had surgery. So then it became, you know, look, I'm a surgeon. I either got to be a surgeon or a healing prayer minister. I mean, it's nice to be both, right? But, you know, if somebody's coming to me in my surgical practice, my first responsibility is to be the best surgeon I can be for that person. Mm-hmm. Prayer is fine, you know. And if they get healed, I had a lady one time came with cancer, and lymph nodes, everything, and we prayed. She got healed, I canceled the surgery, you know.
Wow.
Yeah, that kind of stuff. That doesn't happen all the time, but it does happen. So once I closed my practice in 2008, then I could devote most of all my time, really. God spoke to me and said, close your practice, because now you can work for me full-time, pray for people. Then I went to work at the Dream Center. Well, I was working for, I had no salary. It wasn't any gain I was getting. So I could practice general stuff and still pray for them and, you know, watch them get healed. That was probably the best time of my life there.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So that was a good question. God put that question out there. I don't want to hold you guys. What do we have next? Is there like a break or something?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Does any
30-minute break and then the next set of workshops.
Okay.
I think, Dr. Mike, you need to pray and bless each person around the circle.
I want to do that for sure. Yeah. Yeah. Good.
Make the rounds. Your doctor. Go. Go to each room.
Okay, I'm going to stop the recording.
Yeah.
Oh, you stopped the recording. Okay.
He may have prophetic words, so I'm going to continue.
Okay.
What I'd like is let's all stand. Let's all get in a circle. Let's all hold hands or. You know, have some sort of physical.
You can do that.
I know some sort of physical contact.
Sorry, you can do that.
And I'm going to start. But I want. I'm going to do it a little differently. I'm going to start the prayer, and I want you guys to each pray, and then I'll come around and bless you and anoint you with oil. How's that sound? Mm. So, Lord, what a wonderful day! This is the day that you have made. There's no question about it, Lord. That the fact that we're here. In this group, Lord, speaks to that so well, Lord. So teach us, Lord, to be the best healing disciples that we could possibly be for you, Lord. Just write on our hearts, each one of us, how you would have us do that. And if we're OSL conveners or we're thinking about being conveners, Lord, you just tell us what to do. Give us the next words, the next steps, because we know that as long as we're discipled by you, we're getting the right training, and that everything that you teach us is what we need to do. So bless these people and be with us. And we thank you so much for this time together. In Jesus' name, and I invite your prayers now.
Amen. Lord, we lift up each person here.
Yes, Lord.
each broken part and each hurting part and mm-hmm. each part that's willing to step out where you lead. We ask for clear vision and direction and enthusiasm to move where you want us to move thank and you, do Lord. The work you have given us to do.
Jesus.
And we thank you for each person here, and we thank you for the work they've done and the work that they will do. We thank you in Jesus' name.
And Lord, we pray for our OSL healing communities, ours and ones that may be forming, and all of them around the world. And we pray for that mission piece. Often we can get kind of closed up in our own, just praying for each other. And so we just pray for revival for those teams, to that God would show us how to be missionary people and how to go out and pray and where to do that. We just ask the Holy Spirit to move and spark that desire in all of our healing communities around the world.
Yes, Lord, give us confidence. Help Dr. Mike here has said today to be contagious in us, and help us be bold, because they will be your words, not ours, and that we can spread your love to all those who don't know it, Lord. Oh, thank you, God. Bless each here in this circle and all those with that desire to know you and know how to go forward in that, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father, I pray that you'd send your Holy Spirit and strength to everyone attending and holding this conference, that each one here will have such a strong encounter with you that they will remember it for years to come. Lord, please reach down and come to us. Thank you.
Yes.
Lord, we recognize that you are the potter, we're the clay, and that you are forming us. Even when we fight against it and struggle with it, you still lovingly hold us close to your heart and lead us. So thank you for Dr. Mike and his encouragement and challenge, really, to see ourselves as followers of Jesus, disciple, being discipled by you.
And all to your glory, God. All to your glory, not ours, yours.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to anoint you guys with oil and impart I'm going to impart incredible gifts over you. So, Chris, I anoint you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I pray for that the gifts of the Holy Spirit would just abound in you as you go forth to lead your OSL community, in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
And Laura, I anoint you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and I just say, come Holy Spirit, and just fall all over your daughter as she leads the community that she has been given, Lord, and that you would lead her into all truth, and that your Spirit would abound in her, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I pray for you, Elba, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I anoint you with oil, and I say, come, Holy Spirit, and just continue to fill Elba to overflowing with your life-giving and healing love, that her healing community would grow and abound and be led by you into further discipleship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And Janine, I anoint you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that God would do a great work in you now and lead you in just the way that you would go. Come, Holy Spirit, fill her anew and guide her into all truth. In Jesus' name,
amen.
Amen. And Brother John, I anoint you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I pray God's blessing over you and over your family, over your wife, and over your ministry, and over all you mean to us and OSL, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you.
And I just bless you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And I say, come Holy Spirit, and just fill this sister up to overflowing with your life-giving and healing love, that as she goes forth into all the world to proclaim the gospel, that you would go with her and that you would show her the way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And Art, I just anoint you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and I pray a blessing over you for your life and for your ministry and for what God would lead you into in this season of your life. And we just pray that you would continue to follow him and serve him all the days of your life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You want to anoint me with oil? I don't mind.
Oh,
but you got your hand full.
I've got somebody that will do this beautifully.
I might fall over. I don't know.
It's all right. I was afraid I'd lose the camera.
Dr. Mike, I anoint you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
You going to pray?
I can. I think we also pray.
Okay.
And we'll use the formula, I bless you, Dr. Mike, with. Okay. So we'll go around this way and I'll finish up. So Hans, so Hans, you start. I bless you, Dr. Mike, with.
I bless you, Dr. Mike, with more and stronger communication and hearing the words from God, that he would speak to you even more clearly than he has in the past.
Amen. Amen. I bless you, Dr. Mike, with whatever God puts in your heart. Okay? Can you do that? No? Okay, that's fine. So I bless you, Dr. Mike.
I'm sorry, my eyes were shut.
That's all right.
I bless you, Dr. Mike, with everything God has for you that lies ahead of you. Bless you in all of it.
Thank you, Jesus.
An exciting adventure awaits. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm.
I bless you, Dr. Mike, in the name of Jesus, with the peace of Christ. He would surround you with his peace.
Thank you, Lord.
I bless you. I bless you, Dr. Mike, with even more joy, with even more accomplishment, with even more walking with Jesus and knowing that you're walking right with him.
Thank you, Lord.
I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I bless you, Dr. Mike, with wisdom, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
And Dr. Mike, I bless your ears that you may hear well. Jesus said he only spoke what he heard the Father say. And I bless your eyes that Jesus said, I only do what I see the Father doing, that you may keep in step with the Spirit and walk closely with him. I bless you in your walk with him.
Lord,
bless you.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. I receive all that with much gratitude and thanksgiving. And bless you.